and gentlemen, this is a regularly scheduled meeting of the Sunderland Board of Selectmen. We're running a little bit late, like 7 minutes, because frankly, we were just yucking it up before the camera started running. We can call to order at 6:36. We're going to start tonight with what has become really a wonderful annual event here, and it's Gary comes to talk about Berkshire's to Boston and maybe stopping here in the town of Sunderland. So we're also going to have a kind of an open discussion after this, 6:45-ish. About complete streets planning. Both David and Sherry have been to some complete streets training. It's very similar to Pathways work. How do you integrate the benefits of multimodal transportation in streetscaping and street interfacing with people? It sounds kind of dry, but it's fascinating stuff. We're going to have that first conversation with a goal there to be moving forward toward our complete streets grant application. We have a calendar to talk about because, God forbid, it's springtime in Sunderland, which means the calendars all come out and it counts down to town meeting, warrants, etc. And then some appointments with some folks down at the public wing side of the fence. So we can start earlier. I'm sorry. We are starting a little late tonight, and Gary's in to talk with us about Berkshire to Boston. And we have beautiful cars in front of us. For that. Okay. Thanks, Gary.
Well, thanks so much, Scott. It is a real pleasure to be back here as I come see you every year about this time to talk about the Berkshires to Boston Bicycle Tour, which is a bicycle tour across Massachusetts that stops here in Sunderland on Thursday, September 15th this year. And we'll have about 160 riders this year. Every year it's growing by about 20 to 25%, which is very exciting. We've had registration open for only about 3 weeks, and we have riders from Canada as well as 15 US states signed up already, which is really good. So we've got riders from as far away as California and Idaho and Arizona and Texas and over New England and the Eastern Seaboard. One of the riders that called me very early on is already becoming a little bit of a celebrity. She called from Idaho, and she was very interested in coming out to do the ride with us this year. She's just completing, partway through this year, she will finish up a five-year goal to pedal over 24,000 miles the distance around the globe. So she's happy to be doing that. She won't finish that effort when she's here in Boston, but it's quite a feat for anyone. And it's especially noteworthy for her because she's 74 years old.
Nice.
In the past 4 years or 5 years, will have completed that trek. So we know that the 240 miles across Massachusetts by the route we use will be a piece of cake for Barb. We're very excited to have her and lots of others. And as I tell you every year, our riders are always so thrilled to come to Sunderland. It is literally one of the most charming communities in Massachusetts, in my experience. And they love the friendliness of the businesses here. We work with Bub's Barbecue and the Bridgeside Grill, and the folks at the Congregational Church are always so helpful in providing that space. And folks just love wandering around, getting pictures with the buttonball tree, and we just have such a lovely bikeable community here in Sunderland, and obviously coming down through the Franklin County. So we really appreciate the hospitality that the town of Sunderland shows every year. I know our riders love it. Oh, I have to mention the corner store as well. They are a great partner for us in the tour. So mostly just wanted to come and tell you, as you know, I've sent a letter a few weeks back indicating the plans and the dates to be here on Thursday, the 15th of September. We really appreciate your hospitality and look forward to bringing another contingent of riders across Massachusetts through Sunderland.
So Gary, each year, as the event grows in not necessarily size, but in expertise, your requirements see change a little bit. You refine the process, refine the kinds of elements that go with the tour. And in this particular year, is there anything that changes for the request for the town itself?
Not really.
Physical space, timing,
hospitality? Physical space, I think, is fine. We bring in porta johns and a shower truck that we hook up to the town water. We take advantage of the two toilet facilities down in the ball field and open those up, clean those up before we come in and then after we leave. So really no significant changes there. I think we've found a good rhythm here in Sunderland. It works very well. And so if it ain't broke, don't fix it.
Great point. Appreciate that. Tom or David?
I think looking forward to it again this year. It's a great thing to have in the town and for the area. So.
That's why we got the pathways committees and exactly doing what Mr. Greer's talking about. So bring it home, Mr. Greer.
We will bring it home. In fact, we're also doing a couple of other events this year. We've introduced a new ride called the Riverway Ride that begins in Northampton.
Nice.
Of course, it comes through Sunderland. It's only about 25 riders. It's the first one of those this year is occurring during Adventure Cycling's National Bike Travel Weekend, which is June 3rd, 4th, and 5th. There will be rides occurring all over the country, encouraging people to travel by bicycle. So we're doing that in June and doing it again in August. And then on July 30th, we're going to be introducing the River Valley Ice Cream Ride, which will have three different routes. The Kitty Scoop Loop, which is about 5 miles, the Single Scoop Loop, which is 25 miles and comes through Sunderland, and the Double Scoop Loop, which will be 50 miles and also comes through Sunderland. Just met with Jim Williams over at the Williams Farm, where we would like to do one of our rest stops there at his farm.
Nice.
Because the whole idea behind the River Valley Ice Cream Ride is to promote local agriculture and local food production, and what better way to entice people to a beautiful bike ride than with ice cream and talk about local cows and local produce that helps make that happen. Because part of what is so wonderful about our community and about Franklin County, I think, is the working landscape, where there are lots of different farms and productive and economically effective farms. So we'll be working with Bard's Ice Cream in Greenfield for that one, and that's going to be a very exciting event.
Nice.
As well. So trying to get more people on bicycles beyond the folks who can ride 250 miles, but who also want to just do a little one day 25 mile ride and eat ice cream.
Nothing wrong with that.
Gary didn't tell you his best run.
Yeah.
For the 300.
Uh-oh.
Sunderland to Sunderland. Sunderland, Mass. Sunderland, England, and back.
Yeah.
So we haven't figured out how he's getting over the ocean yet. That's the plan.
I thought it was Sunderland, Vermont.
Yeah.
Oh, it must have probably got lost in the translation. I thought maybe you'd go on a cruise ship and do one of those stationary bicycles.
Thank you so much for the hospitality here. It's great working with our town officials, and it is truly our pleasure to introduce people to the most beautiful town in Massachusetts.
Well, we look forward to it, as always. And I meant nothing tongue-in-cheek when I said it's a treat to come in this annual meeting these last few years. So we look forward to it as well. Keep doing the fine work that you do. Really do appreciate it. Thanks so much, Gary. So we'll work with the office and coordinate schedule for the field schedule and utilities. And I don't think there's any other discussion with respect to each year gets a little easier. So great. Thanks so much, Gary. We appreciate that. Okay, 6:45. We're going to talk about complete streets. I've been doing the complete streets. I'm going to kind of pass the gavel over to David and Sherry, only in that they both occupied many of their hours lately with respect to complete streets, getting some training. Sherry has really driven a lot of this elements of this program on the state side. And so now we're going to bring all you folks up forward to come talk about complete streets.
All right.
Planning board meeting, community pathways meeting, board of selectmen's meeting, and maybe Sherry, if you could start with, why we're actually having this meeting with these peeps?
Yeah, sure, just to kind of talk about next steps, what we've done so far and what the next steps might be. So under the tier one requirements, David and I have attended a complete streets training program. Dan, I believe you also attended one as well. So one of the other things that we're required to do is to adopt a complete streets policy or submit a letter of intent to adopt a policy. So one of the things I thought that maybe that we could do is to form like a working group in town, members of the planning board and the community pathways, the selectmen and myself to draft that policy. We have some good working models. I went to Holy Cross on Saturday, had a citizen planner training session. In Littleton, which is probably the smallest community right now that has a policy in place, has one that we can look at. And we can look at some of the others and maybe come up with something of our own and score the policy internally just to see. We need to get 80 out of 100 points. And because we've signed on for the community compact and the complete streets, we're going to get an additional 8 points towards that 80. So those are all good things.
What is the point system? What do we get points for?
For having the complete streets and the community compact, you get 4 points each additional towards your score. You're supposed to get at least an 80 out of 100 points.
What do we get if we get 80?
You need to get an 80 to get your complete streets policy passed by DOT.
Maybe circling back makes some sense. This is a DOT policy, and then grant rounds is what the goal actually is.
Yeah, okay.
And
it's like 12
signage
million.
Improvements, sidewalk cuts, those
roundabout.
Kinds of
things. Yeah.
Not quite that big, but a lot of other things. Like if you remember the meetings we had, one of the things we talked about was getting like some other upgrading the signals, for instance,
yeah.
Things like that.
Uh-huh.
And it's a much shorter time frame for these, generally
great.
That year,
oh,
and the bigger piece of it.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of the things that we want to do in conjunction with that, we can do through this. Like, you know, probably like bike lane painting, you know,
mm-hmm.
different things like that.
Great.
So, like small, quick hit kind of things.
Yeah.
We can circle back to it. Go ahead, please.
And so the other piece under tier two is a prioritization plan, what areas we would like to prioritize for those improvements. And then looking at the road safety audit and the transportation element of the town's master plan, it looks like we've really got a good start on all of those things. So I thought if we had a working group, then we could kind of capture what those priorities might be and
yeah.
then present them in a public forum and let the community weigh in on them as well. We could submit the prioritization plan and be ready to go right to construction eligible for funding.
Does that policy have to go up for vote at town meeting?
No, it's a policy that's adopted by the board.
Oh, okay, great.
Okay, so that's kind of like the 101 part, right? And we want to talk here about the letter of intent. It's pretty straightforward. Complete Streets training attendance has been pretty straightforward. There's a couple of members who have been on there. And then we are at now looking at closing out tier one and moving toward tier two. And so we want to talk at some point here about that brainstorming session regarding the tip for North Main, the pathways work, the, you know, how do we take the five or six kind of similar and complementary components and roll it up into the package that we can put out to DOT. There's a lot of really wonderful work that's gone on, but it's got to be molded, you know, it's got to be presented.
Right. As a prioritization.
As a prioritization.
This is what the community has identified as areas that we would like to have complete streets.
Mm-hmm. Tom, questions or comments?
I just hope people understand what streets compacts mean.
Mm-hmm.
You can't pick and choose. It's a total package.
Right.
So if you want a stop sign someplace, okay, but are you upgrading a pedestrian? You have to upgrade for pedestrian use, bicycle use, car use. It's a complete package. It's not.
Almost.
Or if you could, if that stop sign was the last thing, you'd already upgraded pedestrian, bicycles, vehicle signage, and the last thing you needed was a stop sign, that's fine. So it's a complete street for all uses, not just a cars or buses or bicycles or pedestrians. So it's try to make it usable by all forms.
Dan, you went to one of the trainings, of course, in your professional life,
yep,
kind of in the realm. What kinds of things are come out of the complete streets training, right, that are applicable to either pathways impacted by planning or board? Where are kind of the positives and where are the traps we should avoid?
Well, I guess because it's the first time too, I like Tom's saying, there needs to be some flexibility in there. It did stress that there will be. I mean, you can't get hooked on that every single street where you want to do anything.
Right.
You get,
yeah,
completely locked into more cost. But I think I'm hoping that they'll be able to come up with something, because particularly for major, you know, major roads in town, places where there's a lot of pedestrians, people, you know, on the major streets, and particularly where we're getting tip money, that kind of thing, and Chapter 90 money, maybe. I think it's a good thing to incorporate as much as we can. I support the policy, but I don't want to see it be overly cumbersome and overly restrictive.
So they don't use money on state regulated roads, right?
They don't use.
They wouldn't, let's say 116 wouldn't be part of our an application because that's a state regulated road and that would be state funding.
I believe so, yeah.
That was the same, you know, for forever. I don't know if it's ever changed, but bicycles aren't supposed to, bicycle, horses, pedestrians aren't. At one time, there were signs on 116 that they were excluded from using that road.
Really?
That's only when it's four lanes. When it's two going this way and two,
yeah,
going that way.
Divided.
So when you get close to it,
some of us
old
timers.
I think you're right.
Some of us, and I know you've only been here 20 years.
Oh, but you're not counting when I was here at the university.
But some of us remember, because when I was growing up, I specifically remember those signs on 116 about using them
right through here.
Well, but for me, I look how things have changed over the last 15 years, and I was thinking of Gary, because I was looking at Gary at the time, people now bike to work at UMass, they bike to UMass. You know, we have one young lady from Silver Lane that bikes on 116 every single morning,
yeah,
to UMass, every,
yeah,
morning. You did not see that 10, 15 years ago, but now there's more and more people. You know, it's not unusual to find people biking down 116.
It's good shoulder. I mean, it's good space. It's for kids, probably.
Yeah,
we put kids on there, but it's good shoulders for most of it. Just to go to
yeah, I'm just thinking, you know, you look at all the documentation, it'd be great if you could make 116 into a more user friendly, especially, and again, for me, it's a commute to UMass.
Mm-hmm.
UMass is the biggest employer. There are many students living in apartments. Right now they take the bus, which is great, but there's also, I'm sure, some of them, if it was more convenient and they could do it more a safe environment, they'd probably look at riding their bikes also.
Yeah. Some of the more stuff.
So, but again, that's, and I still don't think, and Scott may be able to add on this, I still don't think we have all the solutions down in front of the Frontier Pizza that plaza there. I still see people crossing the road. The lighting can be, I mean, we've changed lighting down there,
mm-hmm,
but the lighting's, I don't know if the lighting is the best.
That way.
You know, so maybe there are changes down there. And people have still gotten hit down there, and there's still accidents. So maybe there's a different, something different.
Along those lines, what I'm hearing out of a policy plan submittal, even if it's for design and matching, whether it's DOT, it becomes the goal to create a uniform policy for streets. Now, there may be specific needs. You may have a big commercial element that's down there. You may have pedestrian and through traffic, less commercial here. You may have, but the policy, I'm assuming, has to have, this is where I'm looking for help from the people who've attended the training, would have to be applied across the variety of streets and streetscapes that the town of Sunderland has. Is that correct?
I think you essentially prioritize.
Mm-hmm.
So in other words, if I'm
remembering. You don't have to do every street you
exactly.
have. You can
right.
pick five.
The key areas.
So these are project-driven components
mm-hmm.
with
yeah.
a
yeah.
complete
where
streets definition.
Right.
Okay.
So we'd sit back and we'd say we'd pick five key areas. Or
got it.
Is it three or five? Or do we have to do a minimum of five?
I don't think so.
Okay. So we'd pick our hot spots.
Yep.
Say a maximum of five
yep.
for sake of
argument. Yep.
And then we'd say, all right, what do we want to do in those areas? And for us, that we're lucky because it ties in with North Main. So
mm-hmm.
I think that's good. So we can look at, because of the scope of this, you can kind of look at a phased approach into certain things. So you step back and you say, all right, you know, here's our five-year plan or whatever. Here's what we want to do on it. And then we can look at some of the smaller components
got
it. Working with this. So.
Connectivity, how to get
yes.
people to places safely on roads and, you know, whether it's
right.
getting them to schools or getting them to the libraries, getting people out and moving. And we talked about that today in the Mass in Motion. So that's why these programs are being driven that way, is to get people out and moving in healthy, sustainable communities and making sure that they're safe.
So we know that works here. When our former highway superintendent put in sidewalks between basically from the Go 10 up that met with the sidewalks at along 116,
yeah.
all of a sudden the amount of people walking,
yeah,
like boom, I mean,
yeah.
it was just this amazing increase of people just by putting a sidewalk there that linked two sidewalks.
That's really what it did. It extended from the school and tied it to 116.
Yeah, it was amazing. It was then.
It gets hopping.
Yeah, and unless you saw it, it was amazing growth. Very, I mean, it was like it was done one day, and the next thing it was like people was like been there forever. It was being used so much.
And you kind of touched on something too, is like the safe walking to the school. I mean, any kind of improvements. Now we've got ones going down the street there, but any other improvements to get kids to school but within a certain radius, you know. Would be nice because I think if you go back, and especially if you've lived, well, probably around here and also in more urban areas, a lot of people walk to school, right?
We've been in touch with their MassDOT as a Safe Routes to School program,
yep.
and we've been
yep.
Like priming them to do an infrastructure assessment and in hoping to get funding for the road and the sidewalks. And we've been looking into the pathways, possibility of a pathway from the school to 116. That's
on those lines. It was a fascinating discussion in January with the mayor of Salem, where they integrated a safe pathway, safe routes to school. With a senior safe route, because most of theirs is an urban setting. They're like, you know, it's not always the same thing
right.
when you have, you know, kids in walkways, but you also have someone who simply may want to go to the grocery and walk down the same sidewalk, and where are the cuts, and what are the runouts, and how does it work, and what's the curb height, and what's the signage, and timing. What is the timing?
Right.
Timing for a second grader is different than an octogenarian.
Right.
Like good points, you know. So
yeah.
it was fascinating, kind of integration there, and that. And she was thrilled about the whole, you know, the fact that we're talking about it in a complete definition of complete streets
right.
to the best that we know it now. It's
yeah.
fascinating.
I just wanted to point out, going back to what you're talking about, the prioritization that we in our transportation
mm-hmm.
plan we have this map that it's. Listed all of the mapped out all of the different projects that are recommended, and there's also a chart in the transportation plan that kind of lays out priorities across and all that. So there's a really good starting point for this.
And it's big and boldly colored.
Yeah,
exactly.
Always a plus.
I think a lot of it works for done. just needs to be, the council has to, you have to package it and get it ready for this program.
Right, and it's written in the right kind of language already too, so it's just that, we'll be able to lift stuff very easily on that.
I guess the only other point, Scott, that I'd like to make is that, the 12 million, there's grants up to 400,000 available. But the end of that program is June 30th, 2017, so that's why we had to push it. We need to get together and figure it out and keep moving so that we're ready and in position when those funds are announced.
The application process, but what I'm hearing about that, that is a closing date for the program, expended, closed out, done.
Oh, wow, really?
Money's already there, it's 12.5 million, but it must be spent by June 30th, 2017, so.
Well.
Now we get to see how agile the actual state can be.
Yes.
It's nice, nice to, you know, mobilize all these people, but.
Another thing that's been on our radar is the South Main sidewalks, and, we had been hoping to go in for a Mass Works grant, but we've just been waiting to see what happens with North Main, because we want it to be consistent, so I don't know if the timing would work to go in for that.
Good points, Sarah. You also want to weigh in on that, kind of the discussion about the complete streets itself? I mean, active cycling, active in pathways. We have very, very diverse needs here in the town, again, from age range to transportation modes. And we have streets that are laid out for frankly, trucks and speed.
I think that the North Main project is really such a key project for us, because it's going to be the first place where we're going, as a community, I think, going to be able to demonstrate this is what we mean by complete streets, this is the way we integrate it, and this is the way we both preserve the community character that we want and provide for the transportation options that we want. And so I know we've got that design out there, and we're trying to move that piece along, but I think we really have to get the North Main Street piece right. So that it works for that neighborhood, would be transferable to the South Main Street neighborhood, and would give us many of the design elements that we would want to incorporate in other places in town. So I think this is a really critical one that I know there's been a lot of great conversation in town, and we need to bring that piece home. So.
And your experience, again, circling back to your professional life,
yep.
Do you think there's inherent tension between the tip, we've seen some standard design pressure, and then this kind of complete approach and saying, okay, well, we want standard design, however, we also want to have complete streets?
I think the complete streets kind of is a newer program. I think it's really in a transitional phase right now. There's definitely some tension there, and I'm hoping that they can work it out and help us come up with something that works.
It would be disheartening to have a project that's got its own life cycle and then what feels like kind of an appendage, when you would want them to ideally be tied together. Not necessarily even from a funding point of view, but from what Gary said earlier about really having that be the template for kind of the core of the town and the kind of decision making for future projects. It'd be interesting to see how that plays out. Especially it being a DOT program.
Right.
DOT program one, DOT program two.
Right.
It's interesting.
Yeah. Especially when you look at the timelines of these projects too, they're very long. So that's all the more reason to get it right the first time, because we're not going to be able to revisit it for the long time.
Exactly. You don't get do-overs in transportation planning for another 25 years.
Right. Great point, Gary. Bob or Rock, you want to weigh in? Going good?
No.
Tom, anything to think about? Go ahead, Bob.
A quick question. The roads are paid for, I think, a lot through excise taxes.
Excise and fuel. And debt.
And debt. Mm-hmm. And the question that I would have is, since as an owner of an automobile, mm-hmm. I pay for part of the roads, mm-hmm. why shouldn't the bicyclist also have an excise tax?
Sure.
Consistent paying for the
good
roads.
Good point. Good point. Yeah, interesting point.
Because the more people take bicycle, that means less people taking cars, but you can have more road to yourself.
Say that again.
I think we want the incentives running the other way. Right. Take the excise taxes from the cars and give them to the bicycle people.
Plus, just think about how much people love excise taxes now. And then the state would then say, well, we're gonna put that tax when you buy the bike.
I don't know if I'll answer your question, but I would say that people that buy hunting license, duck stamps, turkey stamps, deer stamps, whatever, they're through their purchasing of those licensing, they're buying a lot of land that everyone uses, not just hunters. Mm-hmm. A lot of conservation land is bought with those dollars. Same thing is that when you look at voting, voters pay for environmental police that do searches. Many searches are for canoes and kayaks that they don't have registrations on canoes or kayaks. So I think there's...
But there's no significant infrastructure associated with those.
No,
whereas if you're building a road and you're going to widen the shoulders, that's a cost. Mm. Not only in construction, but probably in eminent domain to take the necessary width.
Well, it's interesting. It's an interesting point to make that, you know, from our country's inception, how we've distributed the collected taxes and fees across what's essentially an evolving nation. You know, it can be argued that the excise tax stays in the town because it goes to the town treasurer collector. It can be argued that all of the gas taxes are supposed to pay for the infrastructure by design, except unless it's, you know, regardless. There's all of these areas. To Tom's point earlier about license fees, you have people in this room right here who have put the touch on the folks at the Mass Fish and Game about helping us with the boat dock over here. They're like, oh, hell yeah, we'll do that. We do it all the time. Why didn't you call us earlier? It comes out of license fees. So I'm empathetic to the discussion. It's also interesting to note that as we go about this continuation of our development in and around our country and how we treat our people, something as simple as the ability to negotiate the streets, I would think we would have long since done. But that's not politics, that's just practical. Ask the guy with the joystick how hard it can be sometimes, right?
It's pretty easy, actually.
That's what I was saying.
It's interesting historically when you look at the public ways, which were all of our streets, and there was a time in our history when people were walking and bicycling. Everyone walked through the public ways, and it was with the advent of the motor vehicle of cars that suddenly they became the place for cars as opposed to the public. And I think really there's a national conversation now that is taking us back to why are we allocating the public ways only to motor vehicles when there's lots of other users who would like to be able to use what had been a public space. It was the way you got around your community, no matter how you travel it at the time.
Good point. Good point. So that said, we've got a couple of these, I appreciate the conversation, we've got a couple of these already checked off in tier one, right? And have you guys got any of these documents from the office? If not, we'll make sure that Sherry sends them out. Basically, tier one, tier two, tier three, and there's some date-driven components. The reason for the conversation tonight was to, again, recognize that we're going to go for Complete Streets grants. Where next step for us is post-training, was to put together a composite group that can work on the policy piece. The policy is an important piece to submit. And then from the policy piece, we can prioritize out of the three or four different buckets that we've got transportation in, transportation master plan, the pathways work, planning committees work, and then, of course, see if we can integrate it here to North Main. And I guess we'd like to conclude tonight's discussion with a general interest. What do you think for a working group, 5 to 7 people tops?
Yeah, I think that would be fine.
So we get planning, pathways, rec, you know, interested party, a representative of the board, probably David since you've been trained.
Maybe George as well.
George as well. But some composite work we'll send out, I think would make sense to send out a request for interest. And of course, represent the groups that are most, have the highest stake in this, so.
We have a tight timeline.
We have a tight timeline. So Sherry, you're talking about wanting to get policy review and completed, and the letter from the board in what? It says February here, but I think they kind of blew that one.
I can draft a letter for the board saying that we intend to pass a complete streets policy and that the board supports the initiative and that we're forming a working group and send that in. And then if we, I'll send out an email looking for interest to the community pathways, planning board, rec, and George.
Okay.
And then maybe in a week or two.
Okay.
Right. I don't even know if I would. I would just see if there's
four
or five people that are interested in it.
Yeah.
Sometimes I think we put too much stress on our elected appointed boards. If you have five, four, five, three, whatever interested
just
people,
just kind of set a date when it shows up.
Yeah, I would just. I would see who was interested, Sherry.
Okay.
Sometimes when we, you know, I'd rather have an energetic.
Keep it simple.
No, I'd rather have someone that really wants to be on the committee versus someone that has to be on the committee.
Good point.
Not to say that there may not be the same person, you know, but I think we should get people who want to be on the committee.
Right, and a lot of us are wearing 2, 3, or even 4 hats. If I'm not mistaken.
Once everything's drafted, we present it in a public forum and have the public weigh in.
Absolutely.
So I guess it begs the question, I've been working recently with someone who says, okay, now that we've had this conversation, it's time to challenge the assumptions, right? What's the downside of doing this?
That you may make a small project a big project. That you're not, and it may, it may exceed what you want to do or what you need to do.
Mm-hmm.
Case in point. When you look at North Main Street, do we really want to make North Main Street wider?
Right. Good point.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So sometimes you got the carrot.
Yep.
Like you eat the carrot.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes you have to. Right. Chokes on the way down.
Carrots can be good with butter and honey and maple syrup. It's okay.
Yeah.
I'm interested.
Well, case in point, if you go to Silver Lane, not to be confused with North Silver Lane, but if you go on Silver Lane, look at the width of Silver Lane at the start, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then notice Silver Lane is real wide because the town was told it was a collector street or some kind of street, and so they have to make it a certain dimension. And Mr. Sadowski and his highway crew were out there and they worked at it a little bit, and John Benjamin was probably out there and everybody out there, and they were making it that wide because damn state said we have to make it that wide, we're going to make it that wide. All of a sudden they looked at it and said, what the hell are we doing here? We're making, this is bigger than 91. And 91 wasn't even there yet, right? And then smarter heads started to prevail, and all of a sudden the road got narrower. And but that's how it happened. I mean,
smart.
So right, that's always befuddled me how we
expect the tension you talk about.
Well, I was just gonna say we experienced that tension in the meetings about the thing where we want to accommodate, you know, the bikes and everything, but also we all know that when we make it wider, and especially based on the speeds that people are going through there now. You know, you make it wider, someone's like, oh, I can just stomp on the throttle while I text my friend here and drink my coffee. And, you know.
See, I would go on Silver Lane, and first thing I would do down there with the white bike, I would go mark it off differently, make sidewalks or a bike path and narrow down the traveled way, and I would just make it visually less appealing to go fast.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, good point.
But,
so circling back around to the tension part, with any luck, maybe this complete streets is a way of taking that standard design and saying, well, you know, the bike pathway does make sense over here, or painting could be different, or dampening does make sense. Whereas an architect, or in this case here, an engineering firm is kind of locked into, you know, the feedback from the community and the tension of submitting a plan that will likely get rejected. Like, what are you doing that for? We don't do that for that kind of money. It's interesting. I'm kind of hopeful that it acts as a little bit of a catalyst for the decision.
Exactly.
Interesting. Okay, so path forward, Sherry, we'll get a note out. Anybody interested to talk about complete streets and worry about or participate in policy development and some prioritization, you can contact the office, 665-1441 or selectmen@townofsunderland.us, and we'll get this moved forward. I appreciate everybody coming in. Very amazing.
Good question. Can you describe how ambitious a project that is? Is it just, you know, 3 pages, or is it sort of a, you know, 10-page report?
It's a great question.
For the prioritization plan?
For the policy.
The policy. Was the policy? Is that, if that's the first.
I think it was one page.
Yeah, it's a few pages.
Yeah.
Okay, good. So you're in.
Thank you for volunteering.
Okay. We'll do it in our meeting.
Exactly.
It's your policy. It's not like your action plan.
Right.
So
okay.
That'll be bigger as you, you know, you get into it. But this is just.
But phase one is simple.
That's how they pull you in.
Reel and raise. All right. Thanks so very much, everybody.
Well,
I appreciate it.
Can you tell us while we're here, where things stand with the North Main design?
With respect to.
We were going to follow up on some of John Morgan had sent an email to the board. There was like
about
five
questions and desires.
Yeah. And I just wanted to bring that to your attention again, because some of them have budget. Impacts, and so in preparing the meeting warrant, capital, and those things,
so
out the board to make some decisions.
Out of the dialogue with planning board and the public hearing, there was some input that went into the designers, the art engineers. I'm looking for the paper. I'm going to see it right now. And out of those questions came actions of the board, and it tended to be more design monies, etc. So we'll act on that prior to the town meeting. We wanted to move forward as well.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Easy enough. Thanks so much.
Thank
everybody. Appreciate it. All right. Next up for us, minutes of the 14th.
Motion.
Second. Motion made. Oh, here it is right here. Oh, sorry. Oops. I had to take it over. A motion made second. Minutes of the 14th. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0, please. So we have board updates. I don't have any at this point other than this meeting here.
The other day, if I may, Mr. Chair, the other day, Sauk County EMS had a regular scheduled meeting. At that meeting, the way the budget's being presented, there are certain things that the town of Deerfield has to do to, because it's like an enterprise fund, that there are certain things that they have to set up that are not set up yet. So what you're going to see on the budget this year is you're going to see that the total operating expense and capital budget is going to look like a $1,362,299.
Mm-hmm.
But it's different than how we do things. It doesn't have a capital budget. So this was a year that we were planning on buying an ambulance. So there's an ambulance costs they're looking at $245,000 for an ambulance. So that $245,000 is added onto our operating budget.
Mm-hmm.
Also, we're looking at applying $147,000 against the operating budget also. Then that would be taken out of what they call the retained earnings, which reduces Sunderland's assessment to like from $230,000 about to about $191,000.
Okay. And Tom, that's going to be out of the out of the reserve?
They call it retained earnings.
Oh, yeah.
They call it, they call it, right now, certified retained earnings are $502,973. Mm-hmm. So, now, the biggest thing with that was, we are receipts that we're gaining, that we're collecting from ambulance calls are well ahead of our projected numbers. So we had, our estimated was like around $390,000, $400,000. We're well over $500,000 right now. And we're two-thirds way through the year. So our estimated receipts are well in the plus side. The other thing is, we're still saving money on the, because what we're doing is we're not using the second ambulance has never worked. We talked about that before, how the staffing of the second ambulance has never worked. So we have a new way of doing that that's working really well. So there's a savings on that as well. So we're looking, I think we had out of the budget that we had, I think we had looked at to date spent somewhere over just over $500,000, $525,000, something like that in that area. So we're projecting that we're gonna have a couple $200,000-$300,000 from that also, plus we're gonna have additional revenue, so we'll be replenishing that retained earnings. Area. So that's so. Let's say the other night we voted to use $147,000 to reduce the assessments. So I think that means that Bob Doobie's going to have an easy, moderated town meeting this time.
Yes.
The ambulance was never set up that it was going to be generate a profit.
Yeah.
Right?
No.
I mean, it's a service.
Right. Well, I mean, I guess if you're in if you're in a utopian world, you would kind of like the ambulance to pay for itself. But I don't think that would never happen, because if it's paying for itself, we'd be making 2,000 runs instead of 1,000 runs, and we'd probably have to have more staff,
right,
on staff. You know, our staff would have to become larger. So I don't know. So I don't know if you're right. It was never made to make money. We just didn't want the towns to have to bear the sole cost. So it's kind of nice that we're getting the money that we are right now from the receipts. The second thing is on the housing of the ambulance. What we discussed the other night was to put out an RFP looking for a facility. And that's pretty much the way the state does things. That's the preferred method in the state. So I was able to find a RFP from the city of Beverly looking for a facility to house two fire trucks and a school bus while a location was being redone. Mm-hmm. And it was from 2 years ago, 2 or 3 years ago. And basically they specifically say how much room they're looking for, the size of the bays, the door openings, if they need any room inside. But you specifically say what you need. And also, I thought it was very interesting and apropos to our position, is that they stick a pin in the map and they say they're looking for a building within one Google Earth map of that site. And say, and it works for Beverly. Mm-hmm. It should be able to work for our Freetown ambulance. And what I did say the other night, and I still believe it, most of us here not Sherry because she doesn't didn't live in the area, but Bob for sure. Marina would know because she's too young.
What? Yeah.
But when Northampton built their firehouse, the city of Northampton had a huge, huge, Scott, you were probably,
I was there, yeah.
Was in that area. They had huge discussions about moving a firehouse out of the center of town. And I mean, that tore that town or that city apart.
It was a raging debate.
And I mean, it was a hot debate, if I remember.
That's right.
Came all the way down to the Beavers.
Right. Correct. And they finally moved. And I don't think they regretted the move.
No, and if you talk to people in the service now and recipients of any service that comes out of there, because it houses ambulance as well, they would say that King Street corridor, although as challenging as it can be, is still easier than dealing with turning out of what was essentially Masonic. Yeah. And then there was the whole opportunity where you put something in that footprint. Now, if you look at the police station, it's a little bit of a different discussion.
Right. So I just think it's and again, we shouldn't have a problem. I think it's interesting to have the conversation. Mm-hmm. If you want to have the conversation, it's a good thing to have conversations like this. But it's been done before in other communities. It's not, to stomp your feet and say it has to. You have to. I think you should have to have a conversation to see where it's best going to serve. And other towns have done it. Other communities, other cities have done it. And it may have been, took something to get, you know, to get used to, but it worked. So I use the Northampton example the other night. So hopefully we're going to be putting together an RFP. We'll put the RFP out and see where that goes for the location. And anybody that has a building or a location, or if you want to build a location and put us in there, that's fine. We don't care. As long as when we look at what we need is met. So that was on the South County EMS. We had the meeting the other day with Marlene, and I think the South County Senior Center is such a great example of how things can work when we all work together. And I would encourage people. And you don't have to be a senior if you want to go over on a Tuesday or Thursday to check out what's available at the senior center. Maybe there's something that you want to volunteer. We're always looking for volunteers if people want to help out over there as well. So if you're interested or you're looking for something to do, give Marlene a call.
David,
any?
Okay, Sherry?
Do we need to schedule a capital planning committee meeting to review the capital items and vote on them prior to the town meeting? And then the other meeting is the personnel advisory committee meeting. We've had a couple of requests. The police department's looking to update their employment applications. And I'm not sure if part of that process will be reviewed by the personnel advisory committee for a recommendation to the board before we post those to the website.
Okay. We'll call in the morning with respect to capital planning.
Okay.
Set the date accordingly. Okay. Anything else or a pile into warrant?
That's it.
Easy. So I think one of the things we have to do is get our calendars in front of us and we look at the dates, and my sweet Lord, it looks like it's time to start the annual town meeting process. So if I could actually start with motion to open the annual town meeting warrant and then set the closing date of the 28th. Motion.
Second.
I have a motion made and seconded. I'm looking at the calendar right here. So it will be opening the warrant as of today. We'll close it. This is for this annual town meeting, and we'll close it Monday, the 28th, and we'll go to the draft and have it posted accordingly. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0, please. Okay, before we go into the
warrant, the last 2 years we've nixed the special and we've rolled the pay bills in to the annual. And still prerogative of the moderator on the board. You don't have to open, don't have to close, and do any of that stuff. It's like
smoother, right? Stream, a little more streamlined. It seems to work.
Yeah. Okay. I just wanted to put that out there for people who are watching and paid attention. And I wonder what happened to that special. Do we just get really efficient and pay everything off? No, there's still going to be bills to pay. We'll take that action at the annual. Okay. So thanks very much. I appreciate it. The draft warrant, if I could make one suggestion, there has to be a larger font out there in the world.
Yes. 6 points, not good.
It's got small for, yeah, right, you're right. Big, I like his. So it's okay. I was actually funny. It is truly my eyes. I hear it. But.
I have it printed out on legal salt, paper salt, was nice and big.
That's part of the problem. I think he has the one that I want. The one with like the number 12 font.
Do you have this?
Yeah.
I don't know. I got one in the email last week. This.
You have that one?
Okay. So we can start with the first review. Can we open the copy? Yeah. We can start with the first, the basis of the review. I guess
is this an extra one, or is this yours?
No,
you can have it.
Is the prerogative
to go off my memory.
Prerogative of the board tonight to vote to include on, since the warrant's open, we can do the inclusion on the consent article. Those are pretty straightforward. Right, move to include, or should we do that after the warrant closes on the 28th? After it closes? Okay. So tonight's a review of the draft warrant. They're trying to be grimly efficient.
Right. That's my first warrant for the town, so I had the town clerk take a look. Brian's had a first look, too. So.
Okay, good. Yeah. There's no pressure on the new town administrator about it. She's had three people look at it already before even sending it to us.
And they haven't closed yet.
Okay. So you know, just take a minute and read through the first page. And is there anything here that's extraordinary, Sherry? This is looks like the consent articles are at the very beginning, it looks like here.
Yeah. The only articles that I wasn't sure about are the boat launch ones.
And we have a separate handout for those?
There's a separate handout for you to, that's why I figured just, you know, take a look. Maybe review this separate handout for the boat launch and we can talk about it next meeting.
Okay, talk about the methods here. So the first article here is Selectman's Report. Second article is create work abatement programs for vets. Third article, use of PEG access. Like
with regard to that article, Scott, we're already doing that. This is just formalizing it. DOR issued guidelines that say we have to set up an account and they have the wording for the article.
So what I'm hearing, Sherry, is that DOR is now requiring an account to be established by town meeting?
Right.
Okay. As opposed through the accounting function, we take PEG access monies in and we allocate it out as part of the budget process. So town meeting has always voted on the appropriation out of those funds.
It's just formalizing.
Okay.
What does PEG stand for?
Public access.
It's a, I'm not sure, public something.
Something.
Public educational and government access.
There you go, PEG access.
Public education and government.
Not the best I've heard. That's a good one, though. Yeah, it's PEG. The next one is, of course, CPA articles. Below that.
Well, it's going to be much more than that.
Well, yeah, exactly. It'll be considerably more than this. And again, we'll have handouts accordingly. Is the 28266 for Smith still real, or is that still
we
one
have
student?
Revised.
One student.
Yeah, we have one student.
Yep.
But we also have to pay for this year because we haven't included it in the budget.
the next article, I remember the conversation with Brian about we appropriated in total, again, these are not numbered, this is the bottom of page one. This article is to clarify that we had in last year's annual town meeting for capital stabilization appropriated correctly the total value. We did not identify one of the accounts. And this goes back to correct that. And I think it was 18 grand of sewers. So it's not a new appropriation, it's a clarification of last year. And then we get into, it looks like, the land. This is the next one is the boat launch, Sherry, where we have a variety of things to talk about. So you want to dive in. I see here we've got an article, and then there is a parcel A and a parcel B. And what are the trappings here with the alternate parcel A and alternate parcel B?
Well, why are we, I don't think we should talk about those, Scott.
Okay.
I think you just, we're going to come to town meeting with a plan. We're not going to give them two plans, right?
And you have that information. Town council kind of outlined.
And this,
I think that would just be confusing.
Yeah.
We start talking about stuff like that.
Okay.
Yeah, we just need to make a decision.
Just about which one? Go ahead,
just the housekeeping thing, but the Harold L. Easton and Associates.
Yep.
I was thinking that that was Harold L. Eaton.
Eaton.
I think you're right. It is Eaton.
It is Eaton.
Yeah.
Okay.
The surveyor. Yeah.
Yeah.
Good point. So there's, again, there's a discussion over the next couple of weeks about this parcel A and B and their path. Then the next looks like it is elected official salaries. And then it looks like it's the budget. And then it is capital stabilization at the bottom of three. And then the top of four is the capital budget itself. We have to vote today to raise the limit.
That would be next week.
Next week. Okay, great. It just wandered into my head. I'm like, isn't that coming up?
No.
Okay.
It is Eaton.
Eaton, yeah. And then Bob.
Capital budget by funding source.
Mm-hmm.
And authorize the selectmen to take by eminent domain. Is that part of that article?
Where are you seeing that?
Top of page four?
Page four.
That for parcel A?
Mm-hmm.
What we're doing is a friendly taking. As you're aware, we've notified all the owners and owners.
I think as I read the article, maybe Bob, help me if I captured this correctly. It looks like this is forgive me, Sherry, is this a mashup of two articles? Article blank at the top of page four starts, it looks like it's funding capital, and then it mashes into,
right.
It looks like it mashes the other, right, mashes right into that. That's a good catch, Bob. Those are going to be pulled apart, it looks like. Yep. Good catch. Then there's an allocation after that, so we can separate that, right? Two separate actions, two separate articles. And then we've got our funding for long-range planning for Frontier.
That won't be necessary, correct? That was a 1 year. That's from last year.
Okay.
I pulled that off.
Yeah.
So actually, I don't have the list. I did pull it off because I...
Okay.
So that won't be on a chair?
No. We did that last year. I think we're just awaiting a report now.
Correct.
That was my next question. Yeah. Will there be a report?
Yeah. So 14 is the CPA pieces. And the CPA, these are not the individual funds. These are the individual projects. These are the actual funding values for the allocations for the fund for the upcoming year.
The other article on for CPA, this is the article.
Yep.
And we do have those articles and funds,
right.
So it's...
Yeah, so this, there's going to be some work done on this.
Yep. And you got some money for, looks like, anniversary? $300?
Back up just a second. Has CPA held their...
Yes, their hearing.
They have.
Yes. So they voted yes on the Rio, the...
Cemetery.
Cemetery, and then one other one.
Yeah.
Sidewalks. Yeah, you've got,
Pathways.
Pathways. So there has historically been two, has been the CPA expenditure in the proposed budget year, and then there's another article for the allocation of the percentages of funds to the historic, the housing.
Yeah, these two articles, they need to be next to one another.
Yep.
That's like the trees.
Yeah, you gotta make sure to be able to raise it.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay. And then you have anniversary celebration. We just spoke to treasurer collector balance agreements. I thought that was one time. It has to be annual.
Or so.
The balance agreements, the treasurer collector.
Balance agreement.
Yeah.
And we always had them every year.
And then selectmen apply for accept grants. Then 20, there's numbers here start showing up now. I see road chapter 90 money, intermunicipal agreements. I'm on page 5 now. Contracts, goods and services, and then the consent articles 28 through. Okay. So it looks like if we're going to be having any area of long discussion, it will likely, of course, be the annual budget and capital budget, which makes perfect sense. And then whatever unfolds with the and is structured for the boat ramp, the land parcel. Not too bad so far. It's open though. It won't be there.
Better tell them you're going to be there early.
No. Not necessarily. All of the pizzas, right? I think, other than some of the tweaking we talked about earlier, anything else with respect to the draft warrant, Tom or David? Okay.
I'm sure there'll be more things to discuss.
Yeah, that's a working problem.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Okay, so our annual town meeting, of course, is warrant is open. Our annual town meeting, of course, is the last Friday here in April, and that date is the 29th, 4/29.
Will that time be at 7 o'clock?
7 o'clock, because we're not having a special. Does that make sense, Mr. Moderator? So 7 p.m. at the Sunderland Elementary School, April 29th. The annual town meeting warrant is currently open, and it will close Monday the 28th. Okay, I think we first draft passes in front of us. With respect to the strategy, we can do our homework between now and next one or two meetings for the parcels. See what makes sense for the program. I appreciate that. And I'm going to keep this, because for years that's kept me honest. I was like, what week is it? Oh, right, it's that week.
Sherry, how are we doing on the town report?
Cindy's been working on it. I think we have all of, or most of the reports in.
I just want to make sure we've been having trouble getting it out on time for the last couple of years. So, and I'm here, it says, you know, we want to distribute at least a week before the annual town meeting. We've been having trouble with that.
Good point.
I also think that, Scott, do you think we can say anything about the need or not the need of having an override this year?
I think the preliminary numbers right now looks like we will be able to get by without the need for an override at this point. An operating override. Now remember, we have a capital stabilization that's on the rate, and that's important. We're going to vote that value, and that's funds the capital. And I think we're going to begin seeing, and I'm going to go a little tangential, Tom, we're going to begin seeing a little bit of the pressure removed from the operating budget, not necessarily having those revenues split exclusively between operating and capital, with a capital funding stream, although not necessarily sufficient for all the needs, it does remove a little bit of the pressure on the funds that we use in the operating side. So again, I give the town a great deal of credit for taking that vote. We're year three, if I'm not mistaken, mm-hmm. and I would think between 3 to 7 years, we'll start seeing that benefit of that. And I truly believe we're seeing it now. If you look at your budget books, Tom, you know, we're in a really difficult situation with respect to the escalation in the elementary school. Now, the elementary school's coming in, and they're coming in with a budget that is reflective of an increase in indigenous attendance at the school. We have more students. You gotta pay for more students. We have less students leaving, when that's a good thing. The upside to that is we have more students, which means we have to pay for them. So there's a discussion about the state and its base funding. That discussion is something I want to get involved in at this meeting, but I think it's important to bear in mind that we don't have $220,000 of new growth any year I've ever been involved in a budget in the town of Sunderland. So when you have one line item come in that kind of a range, it takes the oxygen out of the rest of the revenue stream. And we have to really scramble hard. And we're working on that scrambling hard part right now.
In terms of what I read in the paper this morning, says that there's an increase, but it gives no indication in terms of what the size of the increase is.
$214,000, give or take.
No, the dollar amount, but I mean, what's driving that in the school? It says that they need one more first grade or something. But does that mean that they're going from 18 to 19 students? Or?
Well, no, I think the classes that you see where you're adding the instructor, you're dropping class sizes to like 16, 17 kids. So it's not, but it was either that or having classes of 30, 29.
I think that's the important question is, for discussion on town meeting floor, what is the optimum size and how do these changes
make that? And the problem, it's an interesting, part of the budget increase is driven by the state saying that we're not paying enough.
That's a big chunk.
And that was because of a calculation that was used last year, and we had thought so many kids, the business department thought so many kids were going to go out of school choice, and they didn't go out of school choice. They actually stayed in the school. So when they do their numbers, the state comes up with a number that you're supposed to be paying. And we were on the south side of that. We weren't carrying enough money into the budget, or so the state says. So we have to increase the budget anyways. And I think we were $25,000 short last year, like $32,000 short this year. So there was $50,000-$60,000 worth of expense right there. But on top of that, we did have to add, they did have to add for some of the class sizes had reached a tipping point because we were getting kids in. The thing is, they said themselves, you never know what the final numbers are going to be until you can project the signups. But you never know what those final numbers are until the day. Personally, I'm a little disappointed that there wasn't some altering of the budget at least a little bit. A 10%, 10.18, 10 point whatever percent increase is very tough to handle. And I'll try to expand on why I think it's difficult. The town of Sunderland isn't looking at hiring a new chief of police. One of the members of the search committee came up to me the other day and said something to the effect, it says, that's all you pay the chief of police. It's the salary. And I go, well, yeah. And he goes, well, that's not a great salary. And I go, well, there's many people that voted no at an override not too long ago. And we worked very hard to try to bring some of those salaries back up. But a case in point is that once you get behind, it's almost, if not impossible, almost next to impossible to bring salaries back to an appropriate level. Case in point, the town clerk. But at the time of the override, the town clerk and the treasurer collector were equal salaries. And if you look at almost any type of organization that looks at jobs and they talk about what each job does, they're going to say the town clerk and treasurer collector are about equal in what they, their responsibilities. I know as a selectman, both of them, if they don't do their job well, get me thrown in jail. So I think they're both very important, and I don't think we pay them nearly enough. But the town clerk is making approximately $10,000 less than the treasurer collector. Of course, she does work less hours, but those hours were cut at town because of the override, and they've never been restored. But that's what happens. So. But Scott's right. I mean, you look at an increase in the elementary school, 214,000, and I'm not saying it's justified or not. We don't have a lot of extra money that we can fill or increase a line item, like a salary. We just don't have that. We don't have that ability, and that's what happens. And we have to, and I know Frontier, one of the things that helped us was Frontier decided to use some of their E&D account to reduce their assessments to the communities. Well, that's good for this year, but what happens next year? So it may be nice for us this year, but if they don't use that E&D next year to replenish it, then we have to accommodate their use of E&D this year, which is about $250,000. Plus whatever the increase is next year, and we could be in a world of hurt. So that's on the horizon.
Our tech school assessment, is that going up or down?
It dropped this year. We'll have the budget book with us, but I think,
yeah,
it dropped.
You have less students.
It dropped this year.
It's all based on the number of students.
Right, that's what I'm wondering. Yep. Will that sort of help offset the 28,000 going to Smithbrook?
It's not linear, but it will certainly help.
It was interesting in the Frontier budget, and maybe Scott, if you want, but this is the first year.
Frontier has had a really strong attraction for school choice incoming. And this is the first
year. And it still does.
And it still does. It's a wonderful school for attracting people, academic rigor, athletics, etc. At the same time, this is the first year they're seeing a net flip where their choice is at or just below outgoing. And suddenly, $1 million goes away, or whatever it is. In the unfortunate system that we work in, where the $5,000 cap for choice and then the cost of attendance for charter is through an assessment formula, we've seen over the last couple of years the incoming choice value to Frontier's budget drop. And this year they're projecting it to be at or below the net school outgoing. And that's a combination of choice and charter. So it's really on everybody's radar screen that, oh my goodness, our net is at or below zero for the first time in quite some time. So that's created quite a fair amount of consternation in the budget process. Over the last decade, when it was plus up, plus,
plus pup, you know, it school still worked really hard to ensure that the programs were robust and they could attract, students who are interested in attending. But this year, it looks like a combination of the total value of choice and the total value of charter outgoing are going to level it out or make it negative. So that discussion about larger ed policy, you've seen at each of the budget presentations that the superintendent and business manager have been to. And I applaud the fact that raising the issues in the current form. And at the budget hearing, there was a pretty wide-ranging discussion, actually, about methods and steps to take. However, it doesn't help us this year. And then, as Tom mentioned earlier, there's this ability to pay or the minimum contribution formula and the EQV component at the state level that says Sunderland has an ability to pay. And, you know, we get to go to town meeting and vote on our ability to pay every year. But when it comes in the form of a formula, they say your ability to pay is an extra blank. They're not doing necessarily raising the appropriate part of that formula. They're saying that's what we think your ability to pay is. And so there's some inherent friction there. I used the word tension before. This is actual friction, right? I hope I captured that well. But it's difficult right now in the greater Massachusetts, and in particular in our area. The superintendent was very clear that Sunderland, actually, of the four towns in the district, was the only town that actually had organic growth. We actually had more kids this year. Everybody, Deerfield, Colorado, were all down. We have been down in a slow glide path for a number of years. This year, for some reason, boop, it came back up. So I actually am a little, I know the challenge that we're going to face on the revenue, the distribution of our revenues in the town of Sunderland. However, outside of the EQB discussion at the elementary school in Sunderland, when they simply say you have more kids in the school, to me that makes it really simple. It's like, okay, there's that many more kids, that means you really do have to pay more. I get it, right? We've said for a number of years, well, what does it look like if you had an ideal efficiency model that was only Sunderland kids and it was a value of blank? What would the school cost be? Well, guess what we got this year?
Well, yeah, I'd just like to add one thing. Uh-huh. The other thing is that we at the budget hearing, we asked that the school just not add school choice because seats were available.
That's a really good point, actually.
And what does that mean is that if you get to the start of school and there's only 15 kids in the second grade, then we don't need two second grades.
Right.
So, and those numbers can change that dramatically. And if it goes to 21 kids, or if we have 21 kids in the class, you know, they would have to look at, do you have a class of 10s and 11s? That has to be a conversation that they seriously have to have. And those aren't easy conversations. So, but pretty much, but I almost think with this budget, we almost have two classes for each grade level now. Almost, pretty close.
Each, but it's getting
close.
I know there's a slug in the center, and I know there's a big kindergarten class as well. So. As we go forward talking about the continuing with working on the budget, it's important to bear in mind that that's where it's all going to go this year.
It's going up by one. Right now we have 11 sections as well. 2, 4 with 2 sections.
Okay.
And then 11, 2. Well, they're projecting 2016-2017 to have 5. So that's a modest bump.
Yearly.
But you can look at the smallest number of students is 18. Yeah, that's the smallest number. So we're definitely getting up there in terms of class sizes in each one. And that's one of those things that is very difficult to just make a blanket statement that, you know, this size is the perfect size. Because obviously you want to have as small as you can within reason, but there's a lot to discuss around that. That's a
then it only takes a triad of kids.
Yeah.
And it depends on so many factors in it.
Yeah, you can't point. You know, it depends on the age of the students, what types of students.
Yeah.
You know, there's a lot of factors involved. We've been discussing class size a lot over the last month or so.
Mm-hmm.
And then charter schools, that's one of the things that's up for debate now, is trying to lift the charter cap. And, you know, when you look at what we get for, was it $5,000 or $5,500 for a choice student in,
right,
versus what a charter school has, you know, what we've got to pay for a charter school, there's no...
What is it, 15 to 18, right?
Completely, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Cost
depends
of
on the school.
Cost of attendance. I mean, we have cost of attendance. Essentially, it's like out-of-district placement.
Right.
So, Smithville, 28.
17.5.
And make no mistake, you know, we talk about that with going out of placement. You know, cost of attendance at Frontier or at even the elementary school is in the low five digits. At the Frontier budget hearing, they pulled the number out. I was like, it's like $12,900, we think, $13,000. So, you know, we can wax eloquently about how it is to go outside of the district, but you also have to recognize what our actual costs are.
And it's transportation costs for the Smithville student. It's $15.50 a day for 180 days, so that adds another $10,000 on top of the $17,000.
Part-time
per
job.
Per student.
Part-time job. Okay, well, I appreciate the opportunity to take a look at the draft. We'll review that again next week. We have under new business here, we've got a list of appointments for public wares. There are two or three companies? Three companies. Warner Brothers.
Are you all done discussing them?
Thank you.
You don't want to stay for the public wares? This is the ribbon and part.
All States, Warner Brothers, and Delta Sand Dave. You want to go through those?
All right. Excuse me. First one here is March 1st. This is to the town of Sunderland. This one's from Delta Sand and Gravel, and we submit for your approval the following names for public ways for 2016. TJ Conroy,
17,
16. Speak for 2017? Okay. I'll skip the address, I'll just read the names. TJ Conroy Jr., Melinda Gibbons, Jane Kaczynski, Rachel Martin, and Craig Warner. And then from Warner Brothers, we have, please appoint the following personnel as public weighers: Dave Peruse, or Perusi, Todd Jarvis, Robert Green. And this is for all states. And this one we have 17 names. We have Dave Bonnet, Peter Kaczynski, Dean Cloninger, Ronald Fountain, Harold House, Thomas Kelly, Alan Lankard, Ronald Mayette, Jason Massey, Sean Miner, Michael Moriarty, Richard Payne, Homer Parker, Matt Powers, Tim Smith, Daniel Thurlow, and Todd Gustavins. That's it.
Motion second. Well, he motioned.
Oh, right. Oh, second. Got it. I got that.
Got it.
Motion being seconded to approve the wares of the same as is presented. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. 3-0, please. All right, and SCEMS, this is an agenda for, we have our next meeting here is, of course, the 28th. We're going to continue with the warrant process. There's a three-town public hearing on the 30th, and that has to do with SCEMS to get a draft agenda in front of us. And that, of course, again, is next week. The 29th of April, our annual town meeting, and then Saturday the 7th is the annual town election. So it's the fun time of year. Things are going to start rocking. I appreciate that. Any other discussion?
Motion.
Second. Motion's made and seconded to adjourn. All those in favor?
Aye.
3.75. Call us out at 8:05. Thanks so much.